Am I able to see my screen? Srishti?
No, not yet. No. So now we are live. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to DSCI's National COE webinar on digital forensics. I would like to introduce our speaker, Mr. Shashidhar, who is a senior consultant and a cybersecurity expert at DSCI. Over to you, Shashi.
Srishti, just wanted to check my screen is visible to all. Is
no,
my screen?
Yet. No, we cannot see.
So,
can you please?
Okay, shall I rejoin?
Can you please share it now?
Yeah,
now we can see your screen.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, is it okay now? Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Shall I start?
Sure.
Okay. Thank you, Srishti. So good morning, everyone. Today we will be discussing about the webinar, which is titled "A Primer on Digital Forensics," where I will be covering recent developments and career building ideas in this particular webinar. So as major participation is from students community, I am planning to have the basic understanding of digital forensics first and then moving to the advanced concepts as well. So I will be incorporating many case studies and many other things as well. So a brief introduction about me. So I work as a senior consultant at a Center for Cybercrime Investigation Training and Research, which is located in CID, Bangalore, Karnataka. And it is a joint initiative where we call it as a public-private partnership initiative, where the CID has joined hands together with the DSCI and Infosys Foundation to make it happen. So majorly, our role is on advising law enforcement agencies in handling cybercrime investigation and majorly involving in capacity building of police officers, prosecutors, Indian Air Force, military, Navy officer, and as well as IT industries. So last year, I got an opportunity to be part of Black Hat Singapore and USA, where I helped in delivering hands-on session, training sessions, 2 days and 4 days as well. So it is majorly focused on malware analysis using memory forensics. And also I got a opportunity in editing a few of the publications which are specially built for law enforcement agency. So namely Cybercrime Investigation Manual, Pocket Handbook, and also other publications. I'm also SANS GIAC certified forensic analyst. Okay. So looking into the agenda, we have agenda split into two particular parts. One is understanding digital forensics. The other one is career building in digital forensics. Here, to understand the career building concepts, it is very important to know the basic understanding of digital forensics. So this understanding on digital forensics, this part will help you in understanding what are the trends, what are the categories, what are the applications of digital forensics, and what are the challenges. And also I've included 3 to 4 case studies, which will explain the application or use case of digital forensics. So that will help in making you understand better. So moving ahead. So digital forensic definition would say that the application of science to the identification, collection, examination, and analysis of data while preserving the integrity of the information and maintaining a strict chain of custody for the data. So I have included this slide also because keeping in mind the student community, so this will help in understanding what exactly is digital forensics is. To make you understand in a better way, I say it's a process of postmortem of the seized device. So device can be anything which have the capability for storing, processing the data. So which I mean to say that there is an acquisition of that data, analysis of that particular extracted data, and based on the case, depending on what is required, so it will be presented before the court of law. And also here we need to follow the chain of custody, where we call it as the documentation of each steps in your investigation. So that is also very important. And also in each step, we need to plan to have this hash values generated for proving the integrity in the later stages of the trial. So why digital forensics is required? So to answer this question, I have taken some facts and figures from National Crime Records Bureau, where I put all the statistics comparative of this particular thing. So explaining how many cases have been registered over the years. So this, we can look into this particular graph and say that yes, we have seen the hike or rise in cyber crimes. So when I say rise in cyber crime, there is lots of opportunities for digital forensics capabilities. So these are these cases are registered under IT Act and also IPC. The IT Act is a cyber law where we call it as Information Technology Act 2000, amended 2008, and IPC is Indian Penal Code. And also Indian Computer Response team, also called as CERTIN, has got this particular cyber security incident handled in the year 2008. So it is majorly classified in phishing, network scanning, virus, malicious code, website defacement, then website intrusion and malware propagation, others. So here what we need to look at is the cases which they have handled has crossed 2 lakhs, which mean to say there are lots of opportunities. Okay, so you may be aware of this phishing and all. So I'm moving to next thing so that you will understand better in the case studies. So to make you understand, I put this case study.
Shashi, I think you are not audible. Shashi, can you hear me?
I think you are not audible. Can you please try to unmute yourself?
Yeah, hope I am audible now.
Yeah.
Okay, shall I continue?
Yes.
Okay. So this case study. So first of all, I will explain what is the case is. A movie production house alleged that an unknown person had stolen an unreleased movie from managing director's laptop. So I have not involved the step-by-step process of investigation here, mainly I'm concentrated more on digital forensic artifacts which can be fetched. So here, in this particular case, the police, the movie production house has lodged the complaint in the police station, and the police has taken this case up and they have seized the managing director's laptop. Then, when it is subjected to disk forensics, we found many artifacts available in the Windows registry. So here, before moving ahead, we need to understand what is registry. So the registry is the database where the system, basic system configuration is stored, and it will keep record of all the peripherals, attached devices, and installed applications, and many other things which is related to system, and also the user activities also is stored in this particular thing. So here in the Windows registry, a USB device entry was found. So which say that the Plexter DVD RPX810SA. So this is quite interesting because there was no DVD writer was installed by default in that particular laptop. And also to support this, we found the software key which was used to burn that particular DVD. And also we found the compilation files, including ISO image, so which is specifically for DVD, with created date and time. So this created date and time with the ISO image is very important. So proving the time and correlating the time with other artifacts is very important in digital forensics. And also the images contained DVD format and AVI format versions of copyrighted movies was also present in this. And also when we got this created date and time, we analyzed the CCTV footage with respect to the created date and time of the ISO image file, and learned that there was an employee entered into the MD's cabin. So this is how we can connect with the artifacts based on time. This is called correlation. So digital forensics process. So digital forensics process involves mainly identification, acquisition, analysis, and reporting part. Let us understand in depth. Identification is nothing but understanding what is the device seized, how the data is stored in that particular thing, what type of data is stored, what type of device the particular thing is. We need to identify those things, and we need to plan to use the tools and technologies which matches to that particular thing. Then coming to the next step, the acquisition part. Now we are trying to acquire the data from the device. There are varieties of devices, and each device demands for its own acquisition process. Okay, and also it depends on the scene also, whether you entered into the scene of offense, system is in on condition, off condition. It depends how to use this particular step, like acquisition, how you can do that. Fine. So acquisition mainly deal with extraction of the stored content from the device. Next step, 3, analysis part. So this analysis part, we are extracting the important artifacts which are available in the acquired image, and we are identifying the artifact which will help in prove or disproving the case, and only those artifacts are put into the report and it is submitted to the court of law. So this is how it will follow. So major categories in digital forensics. So for building the career, this will definitely help in identifying what are the domains which are available. So disk forensics. So disk forensics is conducted on hard disk of laptop, computer, and also external hard disk, USB devices, etc. So here in this process, we acquire the data from these storage devices and analyze, and we generate the report. The same process is followed in this particular disk forensics as well. And also here, the important thing is we recover the deleted data as well from the unallocated sectors. Email forensics. So this email forensics mainly deals with identifying the source of the email source of the email originated. And also now, since we have lots of email generated every day, it also makes sense that we need to figure out, based on the keyword search, we can identify the particular subject, or we can identify the particular attachment. So those things will be dealt in this particular email forensics. So next, browser forensics. So browser forensics is concentrated mainly on web browsers, Internet Explorer, Chrome, Safari, and many other web browsers. So here it will disclose the history of the web browser history mainly, and what are the Google search he has done, and many other stuffs. And also, if it is deleted, also we can recover from this. Live forensics. So live forensics, if there is a need, like say suppose you enter into the scene, if the system is in on condition, then only you can conduct this live forensics. If it is off condition, only the dead forensic can be done. Like I said, in disk forensics, we can do the. In live forensics, we have an advantage of getting the live data. Say, for example, what are the network connections it is making, and what are the ARP tables, and what are the basic things which you can see, what are the files in the desktop, and all those simple things. And also, this will help in extracting the memory dump, which is the content which is available in the RAM, where we can extract using the tools such as FTK Lite, Dump It, Triage IR. I will be explaining this later stages. So next, coming up to memory forensics. So after extracting this particular memory dump from the system, we can conduct memory forensics on that particular dump. So I mean to say that we can identify the artifacts such as malwares. So this memory forensics is getting more popular nowadays because of the sophisticated attacks from the malware authors. So they are using the fileless malwares nowadays. The fileless malwares are the malware which will be injected into the memory itself. It will not be mapped on the disk. So it will be only in the memory. It will download directly into the memory. It will run from that memory. And after its job, it will suicide by itself. So I mean to say, there is no traces available in the disk forensics. Next, coming up to network forensics. This is mainly focused on analysis of the network traffic, packet analysis, and also this will majorly help in intrusion detection. Mobile device forensics. So we have mobile device forensics. In this particular thing, we have the logical extraction, then physical extraction. Also, we have JTAG and chip-off to do the invasive forensics as well. So this is mainly deals with collecting the information from the mobile. For example, call logs, then GPS locations, etc. Database forensics. The database forensics is mainly focused on the study of databases, which will revolve around SQLite mainly, because lots of applications available in the mobile phones are using SQLite. So the SQLite for this particular database forensic is more concentrated on this particular SQLite database. So cloud forensics, so this is not like the traditional way of extracting the data from the devices. It's in cloud where we need the authentication, like credentials and all, to get into this. This is where the law enforcement and many other industry also facing issues of getting this particular data. So IoT forensics, this is not matured yet, and the IoT forensics majorly deals with extraction of the content from the drone, Amazon Alexa, and many other IoT devices. So types of investigation. So types of investigation include civil investigation. So this will help in investigation of the civil cases where there is a need to uncover the evidence which is required for the trial. So administrative investigation. So this will be conducted by the corporate or enterprise, and this majorly deals with violation of IT policy or guidelines, HR issues, majorly the internal investigation, I can say. So criminal investigation, this is conducted by central and state investigating agencies, for example CBI, then CID. So they will be conducting this kind of investigations. So this majorly include homicide, kidnap case, and hacking related case as well, impersonation, and many others. So if you want to understand in depth of this, you can look at this IT Act, Information Technology Act 2000, amended 2008, where there is a chapter called chapter 11, which speaks about the offenses in depth. So there we can find different sections for this. Okay. Application of digital forensics. So it's mainly deals with a financial fraud. If any operator a financial fraud occurs, so this digital forensics will help in handling those fraud. Other examples are online sexual harassment, theft of trade secrets, theft of intellectual property, drug trafficking, breach of privacy and confidentiality, violation of IT policy, data theft, which is major concern for lots of corporate. Data recovery, so I will be explaining that in depth. So data recovery has moved to its hardware level as well. Then invasive forensics, which is a destructive way of getting the data. I have some case studies on this as well. The malware investigation, I will be explaining this malware investigation with respect to memory forensics in one of the case study which is upcoming. So latest trends. So adoption of AI in digital forensics. So why this artificial intelligence is needed in digital forensics? Because there is a growing list of devices that need to be examined day to day, and also this include lots of data like text messages, images, and videos. Okay, which the investigators are forced to analyze, but since we have the vast amount of data, and the manual review is quickly becoming impossible, so that's where this application of AI will help in analyzing many of the things, like automating by merging lots of data which are acquired from mobile, cloud, and many other devices, IoT devices. club together and we can frame the pattern, identify the particular pattern, then reveal connections and uncover details with greater speed and accuracy. So this will definitely help in correlation of the investigation as well, which is very important. Next is image recognition capabilities. So this is already used by many of the software developers, Oxygen and Celebrate and many other Axiom and many other vendors are already using this particular thing. So to recognize places, people and objects in the particular images, we can also identify the object in the image and we can search based on that. And it will help in visualizing the suspect's journey on the map as well. So data recovery from damaged hard disk. So when I say damaged hard disk, say what happens is whenever we seize the hard disk, it may or may not be damaged. We don't know that. When we fail to identify that particular hard disk, what we can do is we can get these kind of tools and technologies used to extract the content. So how this is done is, first of all, they need to dismantle this hard disk. Then they need to identify what is the fault and how to resolve it. If the particular part is failed, like say suppose the spindle is not working properly, so at that time they can replace that spindle and they can do it. And this requires the clean room, and the expertise in this field is very much required. The mainly focusing on the manpower, the trained manpower is very much required in this particular area. And it is not limited to hard disk. It is also we can use this technology for recovering the data from pen drive and memory card as well. So here, this is a damaged memory card where we are unable to read from this place. So maybe some disconnection has happened in this particular area. So we need to dig out the pins here, and using this spider board, we have connected this through the connectors and connected to the grounding, and power supply is also given. So using this box, we can able to extract the content, but this would require the prerequisite knowledge of where the pin and how we can use this. And the same with this USB also, USB pen drive, we can remove the chip from the pen drive using the heating technology, using rework station as well, and remove that chip, and we can connect to the adapters and we can read the data. Next, coming up to JTAG. So most people have may be aware of this from the electronics background. They may be aware. JTAG is Joint Technology Action Group. So where this is mainly built by the manufacturer for testing their own hardwares, but this can be used forensically as well. So what we can do is we can identify this taps and we can connect with the adapters. We need to solder this, we can connect it to the adapter and we can fetch the data. So when this capabilities can be used is when the device is in locked condition to bypass the password, we can use, or it is logically damaged. Next, coming up to the advanced mobile forensics, which we call it as CHIPOP. This is the last option which we have to extract the content from the mobile. Here, if we find any seized mobile which is heavily damaged, which can be physical or water soaked or burnt, so in these three cases we can go for this CHIPOP, where we dismantle the phone, we heat by the rework station, and we clean that chip. We remove that chip and clean that, and then we read from the adapters. So better we can have one case study to understand how exactly this application will help in solving the cases. So I will explain the case first. The police officer found a person dead on a railway track, identified and seized the mobile phone, which was heavily damaged, which means not in working condition. Police doesn't know whether it is a suicide or homicide. So investigation gets started after the seizing of this mobile phone. So the traditional way of acquisition, which we use logical physical acquisition using a softwares such as oxygen UFED, etc. If that fail, we go for this chip of forensics. In this case, they have done using the chip of. So they have recovered SMS text messages, which proved that it was a homicide. So this is a damaged phone. I will just explain this step in brief way. Okay. So this is the phone which was damaged. So you can see here the information which is available on the phone. FCCID, which mean to say Federal Communication Commission ID, which is from the US. Okay, they grant these kind of IDs for the devices which fulfill the compliance levels. So based on this information, we can get the further information about the in-depth architecture, hardware architecture of this particular phone, which will help in understanding the chip better, and also what to extract and how to. This will definitely help in that. So here we can see the two things. One is chip processor and another one is memory chip. So we can extract this chip by heating process. So I'm using the rework station. Attach this to the adapter. So here I'm reading this. I'm passing the heat for this chip to remove. Then I have removed the chip. So we need to have the prerequisite knowledge of what chip is and what adapters to use. So adapters, you can use UP828P Ultra Programmer, or we can use Medusa or TealTech. They have some boxes which will be able to extract the content from this. Then we have the adapter where we can place this chip here. And this will help in getting the information extracted. So information includes these partitions which are available in the phone. So user data is very important. If you can be able to extract this content, whole content, it's also will help. So just I have showed you the user data in this particular partition. Okay. So I have another case study which talks about discovering the malware. So I will explain the case first. IT security team gets an alert from SIEM about suspicious communication using internet relay chat from one of the employees' laptop. Information is passed onto the incident response team for conducting investigation. The IT team takes over the employee's laptop and commence investigation. So there are lots of questions in front of incident response team. They need to identify employee's laptop, whether it is infected or not. If infected, They need to identify what is the malicious process ID, its mutex, other associated process, command and control IP, port used for communication, variant of malware, whether this malware is using IRC for its communication or not. So these are the questions which we need to answer. So I am not going in depth of this, but I will be showing you the artifacts which we have, which I have okay, we need to follow this particular memory forensic process. First of all, we need to acquire the memory. So this will happen only when the system is in on condition. Then you can insert a pen drive which is having FTK imager light or dump it or triage IR. You can use these tools to get the memory dump out of it. Then memory analysis majorly uncovers the artifacts which supports this malware exists or not. So basically to prove or disprove. Then reporting the artifacts which are necessary for the particular case. It always depends on the case. Okay, memory acquisition using dump it tool. So just I have showed this how you can use this. First of all, you need to have the pen drive, which should be more size than the system which you are taking the dump out of it. You connect that pen drive to the system. That pen drive should have this dump it tool or FTK light or triage IR tool, and you need to extract the memory out of it. Then after acquisition, there is another challenge. So this is a global challenge which I am talking to, discovering the malware. The disk image and RAM dump in question may contain millions of files. Identifying a single or set of files related to the malware is the biggest challenge today. So to do this, you need to have the basic understanding of how the operating system works, what are the process, what are the basic functionality of the process. The functionality which I mean to say is what is the normal functionality and what the abnormal functionality which it is doing. So you need to figure out those things, and we need to identify or we can classify some files as malware. How this can be done? We should speak on to that case. Maybe you have understood that particular case. So after memory analysis of the RAM dump, we found the following artifacts. So this is a bit interesting. So we were told in the earlier stages that it is an IRC communication, and we found in the memory dump, we found that there is one executable is connecting using this IP and the port 6667, which can be IRC. We need to prove that in the later stages as well. And after digging into depth of this particular process, we found that IT calculator, which is associated with this particular process, using the handles tables, we have identified this. I'm not explaining in depth of that. Then mutant KRNEL. So mutant, for your understanding, what I can say is whenever the malware is built by the authors, they will design in such a way that it will not infect the infected machines again. How they mark their infected devices is using this mutant. If this mutant is present in this particular system, yes, of course, this particular system is infected by this malware. You can say that. So this will work as indicators of compromise as well. And here, this run once and run, this is mainly used for maintaining the persistence of the malware. So persistence in the sense, whenever you are infected by some malware, when you reboot or shut down, after restarting your system, the malware will still exists. It will start with your boot. So there are other evidences which says that the server uploaded, which means that some communication is going on in this particular thing. And here there is a communication which is majorly talks about IRC communication. This will explain that, these codes. And coming to the very important aspects in this particular case, where we found this, this we found in the memory. Dear customer, file your IT returns at zero cost, check now. Then Facebook, then again, the same thing with the Facebook. This is the email ID which is registered in the Facebook, and this may be this is the password. And there is some Swiggy order. This may be the phone number, and this is the address, and this is the card details, and the name of the card holder, and this may be the OTP. So these things we found in the memory, and this is connecting to this particular IP. Okay. So now the correlation. So we did the memory forensics, and we found that these are the artifacts which we are able to uncover in this memory dump. How this will be connected to the disk forensics? Parallelly, when we analyze this particular hard disk, we found that the same subject, dear customer, file your IT returns at zero cost, check now, it was found in the memory dump. And dear customer, this is to inform you that the income tax department has successfully completed account audit for this quarter. A review of tax column revealed that you are eligible for the tax refund of rupees 8,000, which is tax excessive accumulated over the time for US salary account in your bank. And they have given the link to download the IT calculator. So this IT calculator also we have seen in with connection with this process. So now the correlation lies in the subject of the mail found in the process memory space, and the subject of the mail found in employees inbox are identical, and also found that the evidence of downloading IT calculator by the employee was also found in this. So to answer the questions which we have listed earlier, the employee's laptop infected, yes, it was infected. And if the infected has malicious process ID and mutex, yes, we have that. What is the name of the malicious process? Then what other process is related to the malicious process? We found that itcalculator.exe, and it opens the handle file as well. So we also identified that two IPs which are communicating. And also we proved that there is an IRC communication with the port 666 and 667. And also we found some chats related to that particular thing. And we found that based on this behavior, we can say this can be classified as spy bot. Okay, coming to the challenges part. So challenges lies in this way. One is the extensible use of solid state drives in place of magnetic hard drives. So moving ahead solid state drives, when we seize the hard disk, it's very, very much that we can use the traditional way of acquisition and analysis and reporting. But when we seize this particular solid state drives, what happens, the new technology which is inbuilt in many of the solid state drives is the trim command, which is used for garbage collection. Which I mean to say that whenever you delete the file in the solid state drives, whenever it is in sleep mode, it will search for those deleted chunk of data and it will clears, which means it will flush out all the deleted data. And deleted data analysis is very, very critical in this solid state drives. Many of the persons have already identified this, and there are many research going on in this particular field as well. So implementation of full disk encryption. So this is creating lots of challenges for the forensicators, especially on decrypting this particular disk. So even the GPU acceleration will fail many times because of this full disk encryption, and also the password recovery like brute force and many other attacks will definitely fail in this. So Apple Mac is equipped with the T2 security chip. Most probably everybody is aware. Yes, it is a very good security where it will include SDE encryption with already existing file vault encryption. They will club both encryptions and then only they will allow to enter into the Mac. So which mean to say, to take the image of this, the passwords or the credential of the particular MacBook or iCloud details is very important in these particular models. Steganography, this is an old technique where the file is the text is concealed in a file or any file is concealed in another file. So but nowadays they are also using some encryption technologies to make it more complicated. They use encrypted text under the image to look like it's an innocent file, but it is not. And identifying that is also becoming a challenge nowadays. Android smartphones models are equipped with numerous chipsets made by a number of different manufacturers. So as many advanced models, smartphones are coming up in the market, to keep up with that, to cope up with that particular thing, the software developers need to do lots of research at the background to provide the forensic capabilities where they are failing a lot, because most of the models which are new models are not supported by many of the softwares. So unlocking Apple smartphones is becoming increasingly difficult. The bootloader level vulnerability discovered in A5 through A11 devices is no longer used. So this is very important when it comes to advancement in technology. Say suppose I have built the capability to bypass some sort of password. Say suppose it is Windows 10. So next they will release the upper version like 10.2 or 10.3. So that my capability which was already discovered may not work in new environments. So we need to do the forensics again. Then use of full disk encryption and file based encryption in smartphones. That is also creating lots of challenges. Then cloud extraction, as I highlighted earlier also. In cloud extraction, one is it requires the credentials, which is very difficult to get through. And also the cloud data which they are storing, it is also encrypted. So even Google backups, then many other backups in the Android also, it is encrypted. Next, coming to anti-forensics. So this is related to all type of forensics, where nowadays the malware authors or any criminals, they are planning in such a way that they have discovered all the vulnerabilities, as well as they will plan to divert the case as well. They are very good in forensics as well. Once they during the test case, they infect the system, they do the what you call forensics, and they will identify how to hide that particular artifact in the memory itself. So there are many anti-forensics tools available openly, and they are using this for diverting the case or to hide the particular artifact from the investigator. So next, adoption of JTAG chip of forensics. Yes, it is very challenging that to extract the chip of forensics. But the thing is, when we extract the content from the chip of or JTAG using those things, it will bypass the password, but it will not decrypt the encrypted files in the particular phone. So suppose if the phone is encrypted, then the chip of or JTAG will not give any solutions. So look at the challenges. So they have lots of challenges. So you need to look at the challenges as opportunities here. So getting into career building in digital forensics, where do we start from? So this is the roadmap. Please follow this rainbow 7 color, which will help you in building the career in digital forensics. So first and foremost is you need to get started, then formal education. I will be explaining in depth. So understanding digital forensics, cyber crimes, cyber law, and its subdomains. Select the subdomain for your interest. Keep updated. Apply for internship. Apply for the job. So we shall go in depth. What is required in each step, I will be explaining you. To get started, the one and only thing which you should have is the passion. You need to have that passion to get into this field, because it is has lots of challenges to deal with. Formal education. So any technical degree would help. Even from other domains can also get into this, but they need to put lots of effort in this particular area. So understanding digital forensics, cyber crimes, cyber laws. So you know that, you already know that digital forensics is very much required. Then cyber crimes with respect to digital forensics, you already know, but cyber law is also important. So here we need to have techno legal skills, which I mean to say you need to have the legal understanding, which mean to say you need to have the knowledge of cyber laws with the technical skills. So I have listed a few books. I have also started with this the basics of digital forensics from John Simon. So which is very good book, mainly deals and explains about the fundamental things which are required for digital forensics professional. Then we then investigating Windows systems, which this mainly concentrate on file systems, which is required in this particular area. Digital forensics and incident response, digital forensic workbook, learning malware analysis. So from Monapa, very interesting book, and you can also buy in from Amazon. Then applied incident response, it's an last month release book, so you can go and you can learn many things from this. So coming to the training and certification, which plays very important role in career building. So there are three options available. One is vendor neutral certifications, then vendor specific certification, then other courses available in cyber and Udemy, Nullvibe, OpenLearn, many other platforms. So vendor neutral, to start with, I would recommend to go with vendor neutral certification, where computer hacking forensic investigator, this is certification by UC Council, and certified forensic computer examiner, certified computer examiner. So these these are the basic course which will help in understanding what are the areas in this particular field and what they deal with. To make more understanding, you can go with GIAC certification. There are lots of courses. I have just put a few courses here. You can go to science.org and you will find many courses available which is related to forensics. So certified forensic examiner, this is the certification which deals with Windows forensics. Then certified incident handler, this will give you insights into the hacker tools and what is essential for the penetration testing and all. So certified forensic analyst, this is an advanced course which will help in understanding the advanced digital forensics, threat intelligence, and memory forensics as well. Then last, we have cyber law and cyber forensics. There are many PG diplomas available in cyber law and cyber forensics. So since this is a multidisciplinary course, I would recommend you to go up to this, because this is very much important for a forensic investigator. Then vendor specific certification, we have autopsy certification. So it's a paid version, but it is free now. You can go with this autopsy certification right now. Then Access Data certified examiner. This is the company which built FTK, forensic toolkit analysis and imaging. Then NCASE certified examiner. We have a tool called NCASE. Based on that, how you can use that tool. So basically, when you see that it is a tool-based training, you won't opt for it. But it's not that, because lots of options available in these vendor-specific these tools. It is important to get into these trainings so that you will understand what are the options available and you can use it in a better way. Free and open source tools. So this is where there is no fund required. You can download these free and open source tools. So there are lots of difference between free and open source tools. Free tools are tools where it is given for free and there is some trial period also, and it will not help, it will not allow you to edit the code in the free tools. But in open source tools, there is an advantage. You can customize the code and you can use it based on your case. So for example, we have FTK Imager, which helps in taking the image from the hard disk and pen drive. XEditor will help you in overall getting the information of the hexadecimals available in the it's basically an X view. It's a simple tool. Then Triage IR will help you in live acquisition, where you want to capture the RAM and also the live information available in the system. And again, autopsy, it is a disk analysis tool. Now you need to start with this so that you will understand what are the artifacts that you can get from that particular thing. This SylthKit is an version of autopsy itself, but it's a command line. So I recommend students to engage with more of command line tools rather than GUI, because when you you start using those commands, you can automate easily. So you can write your own Python script and you can customize your results. Bulk extractor, mainly designed to extract the classified content from the device. Hash my files, specially designed for hashing. It includes MD5, SHA, and many other hashing. Volatility framework 2.6.1 is a new release. This framework is mainly used for analyzing memory dumps. It can be Windows, Mac, or Linux. So it's quite interesting, where I included the last case on memory dump. I've used this volatility framework only. Then Wireshark, you all know it's mainly related to network forensics. Then Explico, it's also a memory network forensics. Then another section, forensic toolkits. So here we have Swift, which is from SANS. Then Kane, computer aided investigation environment. Paladin from Sumeri, Kali Linux. So these are the toolkits which are ready-made, and you can just download the .ova file and you can run in the VM. All the tools will be inbuilt installed and you can get use of it. To start with, these are very important. So select the subdomain of your interest. So subdomains, which I have already discussed. So these are the subdomains which you want to get into. So whatever may be the domain, the updation is very much required because of lots of technology pitching in and new capabilities of forensics or research. So blogs and CTFs will definitely help you in making keeping you updated in this particular field. Then podcast will also help you. So there are some internship opportunities which are available now, but you can get many in upcoming months as well. So digital forensics researcher trainee, then cyber forensic interns, then SIS tool groups is also offering internship. CBI Academy is also providing the internship, and we from CCITR, we are also providing the internship opportunities. So coming to the job opportunity, which is very important section of this particular session. So job opportunities lies in government. One is central and state law enforcement agencies, which includes CBI, state CIDs, and many other cyber crime cells across India. Then there are some schemes now which are already pitched in. One is CCPWC, Cyber Crime Prevention Against Women and Children. Under this scheme, all the states are recruiting a junior forensic investigator as part of this project. Then Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center, they are also hiring many of the personnel, forensic professionals. Then Cyber Forensic Science Laboratories, where we find lots of experts in this particular field, they are also offering. Then corporate segment, we know the big four, Deloitte, KPMG, PwC, and EY. So they are always hiring for particular posts. Then Accenture, TCS, Wipro, Infosys, etc. There are many companies. Then what are the roles that you can probably see is a forensic investigator specialist, digital forensics investigator, digital forensic analyst, cyber crime investigator, digital forensic researchers. So there are many, but I have just highlighted the few important things here. So to conclude this, I would recommend that there are less players in this particular field, but lots of challenges which you can convert into the opportunities, and you can excel in this particular field as well. So let us take a few questions.
Thank you, Shashidhar. Guys, if you have any questions, you can always ask in the questions column. Shashi, we have a question from a student. That is, which is the best tool in the live forensics?
Live forensics for extraction. For extraction, they can use Triage IR, or they can use FTK Lite Dump It for extraction. And for memory forensics, they can use Volatility version 2.6.1.
Yeah, we've got another questions. Can you please elaborate the cloud forensics parts and its limitations?
Okay, so the cloud forensics, nowadays all the data what the individual stores, it is updated or uploaded in the cloud. So the when I say cloud, it is not limited to the computer, the data which is generated. It can be your smartwatch, it can be your smartphones, it can be drones, it can be any IoT related devices. So all the data which is fetched, it will be stored in cloud normally. So when the investigator starts the investigation, you need to identify whether the user is using any cloud. That is the first challenge, to identify the user interaction with the cloud, whether he has an account or not. That is the first challenge which they face. The second challenge is to get the data from the cloud service provider. As you all know, the privacy laws and all. So it is very much, it is difficult to get those cloud content without the credentials. So that is creating the other challenge, and the encryption in the cloud itself. So when you ask for the service provider, they may say that it is encrypted and we don't have the data. So that is also possible in this particular field. So there are lots of challenges than the solution in this particular cloud forensics.
Okay, thank you, Shashi. So the next question is, what is the name of this tool which we recover the damaged data in pen drive and the memory card?
Come again?
What is the name of the tool with which we recover the damaged data in the pen drive and the memory card?
Okay, that is PC3000.
Okay.
It comes with hardware and software as well.
So Shashi, there's a requirement for your PPT also after the webinar, if you can share with the attendees.
Yeah, sure, I can share the notes with them.
Okay, they need the materials. Okay, and there's a question, is there any process to decrypt any encrypted hard disk that is encrypted by BitLocker and analyze that?
So as of now, we don't have that, but normally what happens, we can try with GPUs, but it takes lots of time.
Okay. They're asking for the government certification for this forensics, in case available.
No such government certifications.
Most of them are asking for your presentation. They really liked it.
Yeah, sure, I can share that.
Okay, they're asking for the magazine or the website to follow for the updates.
Forensic focus, and they can go to DFIR training and about DFIR.
Okay.
I will share this details, like anyway there are lots of things, but majorly this forensic focus and DFIR, you can update your skills in that. There are lots of blogs and many other things there.
We've already answered a few questions. Okay. They're asking about DSCI, if DSCI has any certification program with this.
No, actually, DSCI don't have the certification for forensics. But in the CCITR, we train the law enforcement, which we have the course for law enforcement, and we provide this participation certification for them, only for law enforcement agency.
Okay. So there's a question, why we always clone instead of copying after seizing the material?
Yeah. So that's what I told earlier also, the techno-legal skill sets is very much required. So here to follow three things. One is procedure, legal and technical aspects. So one, you may be good in technical, but if you fail in understanding the law behind that, it's very difficult. So what happens is when you seize any hard disk, what happens, that particular hard disk is stored for the court trial, and we make a clone copy of that and we work on that, because we don't want to tamper the original hard disk. To avoid tampering of the original hard disk, we use this.
Thank you, Shashi. There's one more question. What is the difference between the incident response and the digital forensics?
So incident response is, we can say it is an immediate response which is triggered when the incident happens at the time of the incident. Okay, but digital forensics comes after this incident to identify how this has been how the malware has entered into the system and all. So this is majorly a dead, the forensics, what we call is a dead forensics, but incident response is rapid response.
Okay. And the next question is, which is the best tool in live forensics?
Live forensics, you can use Triage IR and volatility framework.
I think most of the question is fulfilled. Any more questions, guys? Okay, there's one more question. How to identify whether a computer is compromised or not? Any tool which will help for identifying?
So for initial, if he's not technically sound, we can only use this antivirus or internet security. So that can be done. If you are technically good and you know memory forensics, you can dump that memory and you can analyze using volatility so that you will confirm that there is an infection.
Okay. Okay, they're asking how we use volatility tool. Is Python required or not?
If you are using in Linux, by default you have the Python, so there is no requirement of installation. But volatility has the Python scripts inbuilt, so the Python is required for the Windows.
There's one more question. Can you suggest some learning resource, especially on mobile forensics?
Mobile forensics, there is one book which was released by Oxygen Forensics, which will go in depth of mobile forensics. You can use that.
I think most of them. Okay. Recently, we had a ransom attack on an IT company. In this case, from where does the investigation begin?
So if there is a ransomware attack, first of all, you need to understand what is ransomware and now how it is sophisticated. So nowadays, the ransomware is also coming up with another capability. It's not only encryption. After the encryption, it will have that particular content exfiltrated from the device. So then it will say that your system is encrypted and you need to pay using this Bitcoin and all. So here, they may also blackmail you with this particular data which you have received. Hello, am I audible?
Yeah. Yes. So yeah. There's one more question. How do you investigate the dark web activities like case Kikada 3301?
So the dark web artifacts are not available in the disk as such. So we need to use the browser forensics in first place, and also this Tor browser which you are running, which will be in incognito mode, and it will not be having any history or any files mapped into the disk. So the disk forensics fails here. The only way you need to get the details is from the memory forensics. You need to use the memory forensics, then you can identify these activities that they have done in the Tor.
Okay. How can we apply AI ML in cyber forensics?
So that is they have implemented in image recognition, and they also have this object search engines built based on this image. So that is already included in Oxygen Forensics and this Magnet Forensics and many other forensic vendors, but they are still in research, I can say. It is not matured yet.
Okay. There's one question. In the previous case study, one could change the date and time on the laptop, and accordingly, the ISO image file date and time would have also changed. How to tackle such situations?
Yes, very good question, actually. So you need to dig in depth of forensics in this particular thing. So there can be an option, what you told, there can be use of this backdating of this date, and ISO will reflect the same date. So at this we need to identify the time stopping. So we can use the tools available like MFT analyzer to do this, and it will have two attributes. One is standard information, and another one is file name information. So the date will be stored in these two places. One is standard information, and another one is file name. So we need to compare both the things. The tampering only happened in the information, standard information, not in the file name attribute. So we can compare in this way. And also, when you time stop any data or tamper by using any anti-forensic tool, there will be no response from these seconds. So seconds will always be 00000, so that you can identify that is time stopped, and you can also figure out the date time using this information, standard information and file name. You need to dig deep into this to understand. You can search in Google and you can understand better.
Okay, and there's this LLB graduate student who is doing cyber law and cyber forensics course along with digital forensics for better career. So he's asking for your advice.
So he has started in a good way to know about what are the cyber laws, and also with respect to technical skill set, what is required. So you need to dig in depth of free and open source tools, and what are the laws available across the globe, and you can do some research, and homework is required for this.
Okay, so there's one question. What is a Parabean software?
The Parabean is a company, and it the products are device seizure. So device seizure is the mobile forensic application where it is used to take the backup of the phone and analyze it, and lots of the artifacts are available there, like call logs, and what are the GPS locations mainly. So those artifacts can be uncovered. This WhatsApp messages, deleted messages also we can recover, then SMS, videos, images, many things.
Okay, there's a question. Are security operation centers related to cyber forensics?
Yes, there are in many big four companies and many other companies, corporates mainly.
Okay, so I think most of the questions are answered. I guess all the questions are answered now. Any new question? I think they are done with it. Thank you so much, Shashidhar. It was quite interactive session and quite knowledgeable. Hope the students liked it, and the attendees, other attendees as well.
So, okay, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everyone.